first of all, thank you very much for coming. And I also want to thank Juhani Pallasmaa for coming down from Sydney. As it says here on the slide, he's here in Australia as the 2016 Droga Architect in Residence, which is established through the Institute of Architects Foundation. And Juhani, I think, is the third or the fourth visitor in the residency series. I think you're here for 3 months? Or
yes, that's right.
3 months. And during that time, he's giving a series of lectures across Australia. There was one, as most of you know, a couple of weeks ago, which unfortunately sold out in about 10 minutes. So I know a lot of people missed out on that. So we were able to cajole and convince Juhani to come back and not only spend a bit of time here today in a kind of conversation, but also to run a workshop with a group of students from the Melbourne School of Design over the next 3 days, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and then a bit of a review of that work on Monday. So thanks very much to Juhani making the time and becoming available to be down in Melbourne again. And hopefully we can have a nice, stimulating, involved conversation. I'll try to get things started with a few questions, but at the end of the day, we also want to hear from you as students, because the real topic is about architectural education and the possibilities of architectural education. And someone like Juhani, who has both been a practicing architect, has lectured and taught around the world, and now has written some of the most influential books on architecture and the possibilities of architecture. So we have this incredible opportunity to spend about an hour and a half with him and see where that might lead us over the next period of time. So thank you for coming. I want to get started by asking a question to Juhani. And it has to do with when I was about 14 years of age, living in a small town in West Texas, as happened in the schools then, you would take an aptitude test. So everybody took one of these tests. They were supposed to, they weren't specifically about anything you'd been studying. They're supposed to develop and supposed to register what your aptitude was. And when it came back, then you have a meeting with the counselor, and the counselor asks you what you want to be when you grow up. What do you want to be when you graduate from school, from university? What profession do you want to become? And they look at what's in your aptitude and say, yeah, that sounds good, or not sure you'll be able to do that. Maybe you want to think about something else. So they asked me, and I had pretty good marks in terms of geometry, and I could do a bit of drawing and a few things like that. And so when I mentioned being an architect, and I'm not quite sure why I mentioned that word, but when I mentioned being an architect, they said, yeah, that should work out. That should be okay. Now, the town I grew up in, there were no architects. And nobody in my family was an architect. And I never met a single architect until the first day that I went to university and was in my first architecture class. So the background to this and the question that I want to raise to Juhani is, what makes a good architecture student? What do you need to have to be a good architecture student?
Let me first explain to you how I became an architect. At the age of 13, I inherited my painter grandfather's painting equipment, brushes and oil paints and everything that goes to be a professional painter. And I was very strongly tempted to become a painter. But then I became interested in medicine and particularly surgery. And during the last years of high school, I read biographies and autobiographies of famous surgeons around the world, and I had decided to become a surgeon. I do not understand what happened to my mind. When the day came to register in the university, I walked to the architecture school. And now I'm going to be 80 in a few months, but I still can't reconstruct this mental change. And well, exactly as you, I had not seen a live architect until I went to the entrance examinations, and then I saw an architect. But then, as it happened, in the school corridors there were drawings of the Finnish architect Eliel Saarinen, who won the second prize in the Canberra planning competition of 1914. Just incredible, huge drawings, and the power of those drawings convinced me that that I had made the right choice. As to your question proper, I think a good architecture student has to have an open mind, sincerity, and curiosity. I have been curious all my life, and my curiosity keeps growing every year. I think curiosity is also the best medicine against the negative consequences of aging. I think curiosity is a very important aspect. As to how much a good architecture student would need mathematics, which at least in European universities has had a very high priority, I would almost say none. I have never needed to do more arithmetics or mathematics than just count the pennies in my pocket. And still I've had a fairly successful career as an architect. You do need imagination, which takes a little bit courage. But for me, imagination is the most humane of our capacities. We don't usually know about it, but all even everyday perceptions depend on memory, the interaction of memory, the percept, and imagination. Every single observation that we make is partly a product of imagination. I would also say that imagination is the ground of ethics. Without imagination, we would not be able to compare our choices, the alternative choices in life. So, as far as I'm concerned, imagination is everything. Well, I would then say one more thing. I grew up as a child during the war at my grandfather's farm, tiny farm in central Finland, and I was the only boy within 5 kilometers distance. My days were long, and I was bored for 5 or 6 years. But I'm so grateful for those years of boredom, because they fired my imagination and interest in things, including observing animals. I think today, in today's world, something is problematic to start with. Our senses are so overloaded that you have to be rather determined to protect your internal life and your imagination from this overload that in principle gives you thoughts without your own personal thinking. So you have to protect a student of art or architecture has to protect one's autonomy as an individual against manipulation of all sorts, and particularly of the consumer society. I think one aspect of architectural education, we didn't go there yet, but I would such say already at this point, is to protect each student's individuality and autonomy.
Mm-hmm. Mm. You started off talking about medicine and surgery, and it was interesting because your essay, which I think some of the students have had a chance to read, The Landscapes of Architectural Education, starts talking about John Haydock, the dean of the Cooper Union in New York. And John Haydock, in his office, so the dean of architecture at the Cooper Union in New York, in his office, he had a mannequin right behind his desk. But it was an anatomical mannequin. It was one that you have when you're studying anatomy and surgery, because he used to like to take it apart. It was a model where you could open up the chest and all of the pieces, the liver and the heart and the lungs and the intestines and the gallbladder, all of these were individual pieces that fit together like a three-dimensional puzzle.
I remember him, showing it to me and dismantling the body in front of my eyes.
I think it's interesting that you didn't do surgery, but in a way, the sort of spatiality of the body and the interdependency of the forms and the spaces and the enfolding, you might say, of the body was really very important to Haydock in terms of understanding. And your essay or your the notes from the lecture you gave in St. Louis talk about Haydock speaking about teaching osmotically, that you learn by osmosis, that knowledge is not about facts and information, it's about sort of pulling into the body an experience.
Yes. for me, the body, our embodied essence, has become increasingly important. I have written quite a lot of lot on the senses and criticism on vision. I'm collaborating nowadays with a few neuroscientists on these aspects, and I'm rather, I have become increasingly critical of the academic understanding of vision altogether, and architecture being considered fundamentally as an art of vision. I think architecture is primarily an art of the body, embodied being, and the main sense by which we confront architecture or encounter architecture, in my view, is our sense of self, our existential self. We observe certain things through vision, but like being here now with you is only partly a visual experience. It's fundamentally an experience of my body and your bodies, of sharing the flesh of the world, which is a notion of Maurice Merleau-Ponty, a very beautiful notion. We share the flesh of the world through our bodies, and this is the way I increasingly think of architecture nowadays. It's very much a matter of operating with the body for several reasons. One is that that in this flesh of the world, there is no real boundary between the self and architecture, or the the material world. It's a continuum. I often use the image of the how is it called? Möbius strip. You know the Möbius strip, which turns around, and it has two sides, but only one surface. That's how we are in the world, as a Möbius strip, where the inner turns into outer and then back again, constantly. I would also like to say that about 15 years ago, I began to realize that I didn't go so far from my original thought of becoming a medical doctor or a surgeon. Architects and medical doctors do, in a matter of principle, the very same work. Both try to improve the human condition. The medical doctor in the inner end of that Möbius strip, an architect in the outer end, but finally it's the same continuum.
It's interesting. I mean, you do make a lot of references to Merleau-Ponty, the famous French phenomenologist, and particularly this phrase "flesh of the world" or "skin of the world." But I think one of the important aspects, and you bring this up in a number of different ways. You talk about it in terms of language, in terms of how one gains language, particularly as a child. It's not by a sort of formalized receipt of information. It just happens through a process of living in the world. Yeah. And for me, the thing that comes out of that is this notion of incorporation. That is to say, when we say the word incorporation, we may think of corporations or big business, but actually incorporation is about the corporeal, it's about the body, it's about something becoming bodily. And so I think it's be interesting to talk a little bit more about what that means in terms of architectural practice, because I think a lot of times architecture is taught as standing back from the world and looking out onto it and manipulating it, as opposed to understanding the relationship of how one's understanding of the world is made up because we have a body, not just a mind.
Yes, I think it's the opposite. Doing architecture is a process of internalization rather than externalization. You have to identify yourself with your work, with your body. And this also applies to all other art forms. Rainer Maria Rilke, the poet, one of the finest writers of all time, he, in one of his, actually the only novel that he wrote, Notebooks, Malte Lauritz Brigges Notebooks, he has a almost two-page description of what it takes to write a line of verse. And he begins to list things that as visiting all kinds of cities, knowing how the birds fly, knowing how the little flowers wake up in the morning, being next to the dying, being next to women in labor, etc., etc., for almost two pages. And then he says, but even all of this is not enough. All of this has to be forgotten, and only when all of that has become part of your blood circulation. One day it might happen that one of these memories come back, and the first word of the verse will emerge. It's such a beautiful description how difficult it is, but the essential thing is internalization to the point of forgetting. And this is something that I always emphasize to my students. forgetting is just as important as remembering. I think remembering is painful, and it can become a problem. Students sometimes ask me, since I have written, I think by now, 55 books, how much do I, am I helped in my design work by my writing? I say, not at all. The fact that I write makes things much more difficult for me, because I have to forget all of that, actively forget, because there is no way of applying any kind of information or knowledge directly in your work. It has to come, you know, around, you have to have forgotten it. And this is why I often say to my students that information has really no value. Only information that is contextualized can become knowledge, and knowledge that is contextualized with your own life experience, that turns into wisdom. So it's on three levels, and education in any creative field should aim at wisdom, not information. I think schools of architecture today are drowning in information. I would rather protect my students from too much information.
You in the conversations in St. Louis at Washington University, you talk about the essence of learning being an unlearning.
Yes.
And it reminds me, there's a one of the he's not really a philosopher, he's more a theologian, that's been very important to me, is Nicholas of Cusa. And he had something he called the doctrine of learned ignorance. And for me, what this implies is that which is always paradoxical, because as a student, you think that the whole reason of being in a university is to learn something and to learn certain competencies and certain information in order to take the test, to become a registered architect, to be allowed to practice. But the question of ignorance or of unlearning in order to see a project fresh each time, as opposed to it becoming a kind of methodical or a repetition.
Yes, absolutely. I practiced architecture 50 years until I closed my practice 4 years ago. And at the largest, I had 43 assistants. I had one of the biggest offices in Finland. But I began every single project from point zero. I cannot, for instance, draw a door, because without thinking what a door is. I mean, there is no given door. You have to go back to understand doorness, and then you can project a door for your particular project. I just completely oppose to architectural practices which is which combine just, you know, given items as if architecture would be that kind of a collage of given elements. I think you always have to go to the beginning, otherwise you will not have a fresh idea. You could be, you know, somehow blinded by precedent.
I mean, it's interesting that you were talking before about memory, and you know, in Greek, certainly in Greek philosophy, the word for truth is aletheia, or aletheia, which is not forgetting. So truth gets construed as always remembering.
Yes.
That by always remembering, therefore, you can understand what is true. But you're also saying, actually, the only way to develop a project is this need for forgetting in order to be able to sort of start again.
Well, this is something that also Louis Kahn repeatedly said and wrote, the importance of beginnings. And I dislike utterly the current atmosphere in the field of architecture and architectural offices, which I cannot distinguish today from lawyers' offices anymore. The joy of life and the spontaneity and the humanist air is often gone completely. I think you also need the joy of work, the passion for work to do anything meaningful. And why would, you know, applying given rules, professionalist rules, give you joy? No, the joy comes from authentic discovery. Mm-hmm. And I apply this idea also in my writing. Until about 25 years ago, writing was really painful for me, whereas sketching has always been a pleasure. And I then realized that I have a wrong attitude when writing. My attitude was that I have to have a theory which I prove to the reader by my writing. Mm. But when I sketch, I don't have a theory. I'm not proving anyone anything. I'm just going through the joy of discovery with the pencil and paper. Why can't I write in the same way? And I started to write in the same way. And ever since, writing has been a joy. Mm-hmm. And I write everything, every piece, about 10 rounds. I type it or have a secretary type it, and then reread it and add ideas. And the most interesting point is after about the fourth or fifth writing, when I'm not writing anymore, but the text is writing itself, giving me new ideas, which mm-hmm. I never had or believed that I would have. Mm. So I'm giving this also as another example of where the joy and discovery really lies. You have to get rid of routines. Mm. But education increasingly nowadays teaches routines, professionalist routines. And I also dislike the idea that professional bodies would have a strong say about architects' education or architects' licensing. I think university, by definition, has to be an autonomous place for learning and thinking. Mm. And so architecture schools, I think, should rather have a opposing or critical relationship with profession rather than being subjected mm. to approval by profession. I know this, many professionals would not like me to say this, but I'm always sincere.
One of the writers that you refer to or you make a comment on is Georges Perec, the French writer, part of the Oulipo group. And for me, I like to use the example of Georges Perec doing much of what you said. That is to say, Georges Perec wrote a novel in French called, I think it's called A Void. And the task that he set himself in writing this novel is that he could not use the letter E anywhere in the book, 178 pages. And in French, that's very difficult. It's very difficult in English. It's even more difficult in French to not use the letter E. But the point of it was that what it meant that every time he thought he wanted to say something, he had to use a different vocabulary because all the words he would normally use, yes. he couldn't use. And so it challenged him to step outside of the normative response, yeah. the easy way, the regular way in which he wrote. And I think it's a, you know, it's an amazing sort of tactic in order to push oneself beyond what you would, how you would normally respond. And Flaubert, Gustave Flaubert, the French writer, also said he wanted to write a book. I mean, you know, Madame Bovary, some of the great novels that we know about. But he said he wanted to write a book about nothing, which didn't mean it was about nothing, but it meant that instead of a book that had a theory, or had a story, or had a moral at the end that was trying to make you understand a particular political or emotional or social aspect at the end, he wanted to write a book where it was just the words working together. Yeah. And for me, that's a beautiful sort of way of thinking about what it has to do. And exactly as you define in terms of writing, it's my experience too that there's a certain point in which you write a word and then you look at it and you write exactly the opposite and it makes sense.
Yes.
Even though you thought the first word made sense.
Yes, and then it becomes also our hand. I have written a book, The Thinking Hand, which some of you might have read. Our hand also has and has to have an autonomy. In drawing, it's easy to find yourself in a situation that you have drawn something that you were not conscious of. The hand drew it, but the hand also produces ideas. Logical ideas. You find yourself having written a sentence that you never thought, but it's a beautiful sentence, and the idea came from this connection between the imagination, the brain, and the hand. By the way, Georges Perec's Void was translated into Finnish language, and in Finnish language, the letter that is most frequent is A, not E. So the Finnish translation of Georges Perec's book doesn't have a single A.
Wow.
That's a translator's
nightmare.
Calling.
You use several times now you've used the word imagination. And often in schools of architecture and art practices, we also use the word inspiration a lot. But there was a year ago in Sydney at the Museum of Contemporary Art, they had a beautiful exhibition by the American artist Chuck Close. And one of the things that you could buy from the exhibition was a little badge that said, "Inspiration is for amateurs." And what he meant by this is that we often think that artistic production is just waiting for some inspiration, something that comes to you and comes out. And his point was that no, you know, it takes imagination, but it just also takes work. That it's the doing and doing again and then doing even more again that is where the work really comes from. And amateurs, people that don't do it seriously, wait for the inspiration.
Absolutely so. There are many, several other common beliefs. For instance, many artists and architects aspire for freedom. No real artist or thinker would be foolish enough to aspire for freedom. We need limits. Anyone who does serious work in arts or thinking needs limits. Leonardo already wrote that ideas arise from limits and they die in freedom. And I completely believe in this. Also, I have not seen any good writer or painter, or perhaps even architect, aspiring to be modern. Modernity, modern, is an adjective which has very little relevance in the world of arts, where the Stone Age cave painting is, equally powerful as anything done today. Mm-hmm. And art is exactly the area of in human culture which fights against linear time. In real art and architecture, always time loses its power over human beings, and aspiring to be contemporary or modern or novel is a foolish aspiration. So there are many rather commonly used notions which are harmful rather than helpful for creative work. And waiting for inspiration is a foolish idea. You can wait until your death, and that will never come unless you produce that condition by your work, as you said, your severe work.
One of the words that comes up numerous times in your conversations is this is the notion of the authentic or authenticity. But for me, it's a very difficult word to define.
It's a very difficult word.
I wonder if you could expand a little bit on what does it mean to be authentic? Can you choose to be authentic? Can you aspire to be authentic?
Well, I use it every now and then because it touches upon a very important dimension. Although philosophically, it is a difficult concept. I usually mean by the notion of authentic something that arises genuinely from your emotions, which is born within your own mental set, rather than something that is given to it or projected onto it. I would be more careful to use it, for instance, saying this building or that building is authentic or inauthentic. Mm. I think then we get into a problematic ground.
One of the in the text from Washington University, you make some relationships of architecture and painting, and you talk about Aalto, in fact, talking about when he began, that his architecture derived in a way from painting.
Yes.
and looking at abstract forms. And so I'm curious. I understand the context, and I understand the sort of history of Aalto's life. But I'm curious, in architecture as opposed to painting, do we have a possibility of the abstract in architecture? What would be the abstract? Because in a way, you also talk about architecture in terms of its materiality, its presence. It seems to me that's almost not the opposite, but certainly very different from a notion of abstraction.
That's a very precise observation. In my view, architecture is bound to deal with the real, physical world, real cultural issues, real dimensions of human life. So reality is somehow the mold of architecture. But I rather mean that being interested and perhaps practicing painting yourself, or any kind of art, or even crafts, gets you nearer the phenomena. I think an architect who has never done anything with his hands or her hands not an object or a piece of furniture or built a brick wall can really authentically understand what construction is. So for me, arts and crafts are important because they increase our sense of the real, and that again is somewhat paradoxically that is also the ground of abstraction. In architecture, the ground of abstraction is on the real. So I would not advise students to begin to think of architecture as a composition or as a, you know, a painter would do. For me, architecture articulates real perceptions and real events of human life. So unless it is based on that foundation of the real, it's hardly architecture at all. Altogether, I would like to say that in the field of art, opposites tend to be true at the same time. It depends on your slight angle, slightly different angle of view, whether you say can answer a question yes or no, because yes and no tend to be equally good answers in the artistic world.
And because in the architectural world?
Architectural world is, it is so layered that on certain layers yes, but on other layers no. What characterizes architecture from the other art forms is that it is such a messy, unclear and unclean exercise. And it contains completely irreconcilable aspects and dimensions. And that is why architecture cannot be a fully rational operation ever.
I mean, it's interesting because we often, you know, we think of, let's say, in the plastic arts of artists being able to create different conditions and different things. In architecture, we often talk about control. We talk about being able to control the site, being able to control how people use it. We talk about the master architect or the master plan as if it's this notion. But I've always understood architecture to be duplicitous, that the minute you think you're getting it to do something, it's always already doing something else simultaneously.
Yes. Altogether, the idea of controlling things irritates me. I have been interested in weak architecture and fragile architecture, as opposed to the strong architecture of Western countries, which is a tradition of control, exactly controlling, you know, effects and impacts and behavior and so forth. In nature, natural phenomena, they are all fragile processes. It interests me whether and how architecture could become a fragile process. This is actually an idea that emerged in Italian philosophy in the 70s. Gianni Vattimo, particularly in his book on modernity, speaks about fragile thought or weak thought,
weak philosophy, yeah,
as opposed to strong thought that tries to, you know, control as many phenomena at the same time as possible.
Okay, I'm just gonna maybe ask one more thing, and then I want to open it up. So, you know, please be thinking of some questions. One of the in the conversation that you had in St. Louis, there were some comments about influence. And I remember there was a great book by Harold Bloom called The Anxiety of Influence. So on the one hand, a fear of not being able to be original, a fear of not having, again, I mean, you talk about architectural education being about the sort of development of the individual, but is there also not a tendency to over-individualize the specificity of one's life, trying to be original, trying to be unique, trying to be different than everybody else? And so I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the anxiety of influence or the necessity of influence.
I'm not trying at all to be unique. I try to find my place in the continuum of tradition. And this is something that I say here very, very sincerely. It gives the fullest satisfaction to realize that something you have done belongs to a tradition. So I'm not at all trying to avoid that. I'm not a traditionalist. It's simply that there is a continuum of human thought and feeling throughout history. And I see no reason to fight against it. On the contrary, to set yourself in that tradition, I think gives you the highest strengths. Individuality is it's a double-edged concept also, and paradoxical to the degree that one can say that in order to be dynamically or traditional in a living life sense, you need to be individual. You need to take a individual angle to that that tradition. This is exactly what T.S. Eliot in his famous essay Tradition and the Individual Talent, whom I always recommend to every student of architect, recommend. It's written in 1919 originally. Fantastic essay where he explains that tradition cannot be possessed, it cannot be inherited. It is something that each generation has to recreate. Tradition can be kept alive only by recreation, active attitude towards it. I'm rather, I get a bit nervous when someone begins to speak about individuality in the field of art or particularly architecture. It's there if the author has a strong understanding of culture and life and the world. It seeps into there, but it cannot be an object. It cannot be a tendency, conscious tendency.
Okay, let's open it up. You'll have to speak really loudly just to make sure that we hear and also record this. Anybody have a question? Who has a, yeah?
I was just wondering, talking about the like fragile kind of control debate, and if like one shouldn't design for control, what kind of techniques or aspects of the design process can you implicate to create a more fragile architecture?
Well, one thing is that I gave a lecture somewhat related with this subject in Sydney on atmosphere. Modernity has been obsessed with form, and modernity has also been obsessed with vision, and particularly focused vision. I have become increasingly interested in unfocused peripheral vision, which is the area or domain of weak percepts. And atmosphere deals with that. Atmosphere is something rather fascinating, which was understood in the late 19th century, but then forgotten for 100 years almost completely. Now there is a growing interest in atmospheres. My friend Peter Zumthor is one who has written on atmospheres also. Mm-hmm. Atmosphere simply is a weak image, which however has an extremely strong impact on our emotions. Mm-hmm. And then also neuroscience has revealed that we do not perceive from details to entities. The mechanism works the other way, from entities to details. Why should then architecture and other things be taught in an elementarist manner, from elements towards entities? I think that's a wrong attitude.
Another question? Yeah.
On the subject of the thinking hand and how it allows us to come up with like new ideas and thoughts that we wouldn't have had if we were consciously thinking of it, how far should we go using our hands rather than technology or computers, in your opinion?
Well, again, neuroscience today suggests that we do not have so capable hands because of our magnificent brain. It's the other way. We have the magnificent brain because of our even more magnificent hands. The brain is a result, consequence of our manual development of our manual skills. Simply, we think through our entire body, and that could be called embodied thinking, mm-hmm. and which is so important in architecture. So, I think every architecture student should be taught and instructed to work with his or her hands and even an entire body. I would even suggest some kind of exercise, physical exercise. For instance, walking in a forest is a fantastic way of calming down and getting your senses, you know, coordinated. And after a half an hour's walk in a forest, when you come out, you are much better to do an architectural project than before.
Yes. Yep.
I'd like to talk a little bit more about these bodies that we're perceiving when we talk about the phenomenological approach to architecture. And firstly, I'd like to say the eyes of the skin was one of my favorite books of architecture, so thank you very much. This idea of a real perception to me has changed a lot over the years. I have cognitive dysfunction, so part of my brain doesn't receive kind of or send pain signals correctly, and my perception of the physical space around me is very different because of just, you know, a very mild kind of brain trauma. And I just wondered, I feel like there's a tendency to constantly come back to this very ideal, almost modernist, happy, healthy, sensing, perceiving body as though we're all the same. And I wondered if you had an opinion or if you think that there's a capacity to, I guess, fully embrace the diversity of our perception in architecture, because I still get the sense that this kind of messed up perception that my body is experiencing is just on a gradient to everyone else's perception. perception of the world. So I just
I'm not sure I heard.
She was asking for a little bit more about the sort of question of phenomenology of the body in relationship, and that, I mean, in her case, she has a certain neurological separation, which means she perceives or acts in the world differently. And so just wanted to carry that thought a little bit forward in terms of what that might mean.
I think mostly just recognizing that all of our bodies for different biological political or social reasons, or even just life experience, don't perceive the world in the same way. So even, I think you just suggested that going for a walk in a park is a certain way to perceive the world in quite a calm manner, but for others, I mean, people who are afraid of being outside, for instance, like that's a very different experience. So how can we better account for that in our architecture rather than assuming that everyone is the same?
Maybe I'll just jump in for a sec. I mean, it reminds me, there was, when I was teaching in London at the AA, and we had, John Haydock was there. We were building one of his pieces. And the class that I had some students from the UK, it had a couple of Norwegians, it had somebody from Nigeria, it had somebody from Malaysia, from Borneo and stuff. And he made a very interesting comment when he looked at the work. And it goes back a little bit to what you were talking about individuality, but not individual as individuality is the individual, but about difference. And Haydock had a kind of lament that what he feared was that almost like a form of extinction, that different cultures perceive space, articulate and describe space in different ways, and that there's a kind of Western hegemony that's eradicating those differences. So almost like extinct species of spatialization, that we were losing that. So I think there is a degree to which both culturally and clearly on individual case-by-case basis, there are differences, and so the question of how we accommodate that and not eradicate it under the guise of the proper way of perceiving space, for instance.
This is very true, what you are saying. Cultures structure and identify and manipulate, if I can use that word, space utterly differently. And one of the means of structuring space is language. We don't usually think about it, but language is fundamentally spatial operation. When we speak about, you know, in relation to our body, below and behind and above, and you know, this is the message of George Lakoff's and what's the other one, Mark Johnson's. Book, The Metaphors We Live By.
Yes.
The metaphors that we use and live by are derived from the body, fundamentally. So body as the center of observation and gravity and experience. It is a different center for an African and European, for instance. I taught 2.5 years in Ethiopia, and early on I began to realize that, or suspect that my students, their sense of vision did not operate in the same way as my sense. And I started to make experiments and became increasingly confirmed that this was the case. And at that time, a book entitled Culture and Vision came out by a group of anthropologists, which was exactly the study of cultural differences in vision, the mechanism of vision. So we are not the same individually, we are not the same culturally, and neither should we be the same. On the contrary, it is the current tendency towards global monoculture that is frightening. It is differentiation, genetic differentiation, differences in skills, etc., etc., that are our best insurance against unexpected changes, which sooner or later will come. And that is why traditions, world traditions, indigenous traditions, they contain valuable, crucial knowledge for the survival of humankind at the point that technology fails us, and it's going to fail us. So I have been very impressed by the Inca gene bank, which is outside of Machu Picchu in Peru. They are conical pits about 60 meters in perimeter at the top, and then they step down like this and circle in plan. And these were used by Incas in the early 1500s, or until 1500s, as experimental farms, where they farmed to find out which grains grew best at which altitude and in which relation to the sun. And then there is a blank vertical wall on a mountain where they have sealed the best seeds from these plants. Just think of Incas in 1500, you know, conserving best producing seeds for the future. We don't think that way anymore. And I think human life will be more and more endangered the less we think it this way of preserving the skills we have had and preserving the skills we all have genetically in our bodies.
There was another question over here. Yeah.
My question is a little bit about, you told us, Simon, a little bit how architects and the education should be somehow. And then there's the reality, what architects should do. So when class is finished and you start to work in an office, so I was attending a class like 8-10 years ago, and it was about social housing in China, and there were a lot of European architects going to work, and they were like, yeah, making this 30-story high building. And so there was one who told them, okay, you cannot build this way, we are like in Chinese culture, I don't know anything about it, but so the orientation, it should be different to the European style. And they said, okay, we have to think about it, and started to ask the people, and at the end the output was, they wanted to live where it's cheaper to live, they didn't care about it. So this is a little bit somehow an almost contradicting reality to that, what we try to be and what we try to teach and what we try to be taught. But at the end, what we have to deal with when we're working. So how do you make these two things not be contradicting but combined?
Well, I'm of the opinion that we should only build within our own cultures, or cultures that are relatively close to our culture. Culture is something that cannot be learned, genuinely learned. It can only be lived. And there is so much foolishness and has been during the last, I would say, 50 years or more or less, when globalization has accelerated in Western architects designing in completely alien cultural situations. It becomes so superficial. If I understood your question at all.
I mean, first of all, yes, in the direction of talking about cultures, but it's not reduced to cultures. It's also just reduced to so what architects attempt to be and what they have to serve, what they have to submit to contribute to people that are totally uneducated in architecture. Yeah. And so they may not care that much about that what architects do. So this is the what I would say like practical contradiction you face in reality all day until you don't have the possibility to design, really to work on just on designing and winning awards and winning prizes. That for 99% of architects don't work. So they will have to be their clients and they have to work for them. And this is this main contradiction that what you show us an ideal picture of that what architects would be.
In 2 weeks I'm giving a lecture in Canberra on empathy. And empathy, I think, is a capacity of an architect that has not been understood enough. We have become so self-centered of, you know, expressing ourselves. I think the idea of self-expression in architecture is altogether quite questionable. A good architect expresses, again, as I said earlier, the reality of life, the reality of culture, the reality of landscape, the reality of the physical world. If anyone is interested in the idea of empathy, I could send a copy of my lecture. Empathy is something that has re-emerged now. Again, empathy was in the German aesthetic theories in the late 19th century, very strongly present, but they were forgotten exactly because of this idea of art and architecture and design being self-expression. But now there is increasingly interest in empathy, partly because the neurological invention of mirror neurons has opened up a scientific ground to understand how empathy works. And mirror neuron theory also, for the first time, gives tools to understand how a abstract figure, a painting, can have such strong emotive impact on us. I happen to collaborate with Vittorio Gallese from University of Parma, who was one of the two inventors of the mirror neurons. 24 years ago.
Hi, Juhani. In my experience, came across many spaces, I feel like it would be almost an insult to design anything.
To design?
I was saying, sometimes I fill with some spaces in Melbourne, also in my hometown, that any design to it would be an insult to the space and almost to myself. And that feeling sort of pushed me away from wanting to be a designer or an architect. And my question, I guess, is it might be a little stupid, but have you ever tried to peel yourself away from architecture or from the designer or architect?
In a way, I have been doing it all the time because I have been a university rector, I have been director of a museum, I have done this and that all the time. So maybe there has been a unconscious desire to get away from this circle of architecture, but I have always fallen back, and I'm increasingly grateful that I have fallen back into architecture, because architecture is such a magnificent perspective to human life. There is nothing that would synthesize culture and human life to the degree that architecture does. I don't know whether this answers your question at all.
There was a question over here? No? Sorry, at the back?
Most universities have marketing departments whose size in terms of personnel rivals full-time academic staff. And I think that this is being felt in a lot of different architectural institutions just in terms of contact hours, just basically quality of education. You said that it's important for architects to take it upon themselves to almost break away from this trend and empower themselves by educating themselves in a way outside of these kinds of institutional settings.
It was saying that like the University of Melbourne, it's a very big institution,
yes,
a very corporate institution. It has some of those structures that you talked about. And the question was, do you think maybe it's necessary for architecture students to look outside of the kind of institutional context in order to really become an architect?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. As far as I'm concerned, the main task in education for me is not to teach architecture, but to teach who you are. That's the first thing we need to understand. Who am I? Because only with that understanding, self-understanding, we can learn something that is useful in our life and work. Most of human beings never learn or stop to think who they are, but the self-understanding is fundamental in any creative work. So I don't so much believe in institutions at all. The decisive things are personal things, relationships that you develop outside the school or perhaps within the school, but in any case, it's a completely different network than the school has provided for you. And you can learn from human situations in the street just as much as from a professor's lecture. I often have said that I learned more by watching how my professors walked than listening to what they said. There is so much comes through in human behavior, even without words. So learning to observe in that sense actively will be a major source for learning something important as an architect. I'm not speaking against universities, but university or no school can ever guarantee anything. Once you know a strong sense of self and ambition combined with humility, that can guarantee something. But the humility is needed. And do not seek certainty. Rather, seek uncertainty or teach yourself to tolerate uncertainty, because uncertainty is the important field of discovery. Certainty is not.
I totally agree with that. Another question we have? Yeah.
Some of certainty. Like decide when to act?
There are strange acoustical spots where I couldn't hear.
Okay, she said one in your text you talk about the uncertainty is the.
You said in my personal case, the realm of uncertainty expands every day, and you went to some other architects are really.
Yeah. So in one of your texts, it talks about that the realm of uncertainty is
expanding
every day.
Yes, yes.
And but she says she wants to know, how do you operate in a world of uncertainty? How do you make a decision? How do you go forward if everything is uncertain? Do you not need a kind of touchstone in order to progress, to move?
Yes, you need momentary touchstones, otherwise you couldn't do anything. But what I'm suggesting by uncertainty, I have stopped 30 years ago to seek grand truths. I only seek situational, views and situational reactions, and then work on those bases.
Yes.
You talk about going to the beginning and the essence of design, like when designing. So how do you incorporate this idea into your architecture? Like say a seat can be just not be a chair but something else. So how do you incorporate this essence into the design? Like what do you do with this idea?
Did you hear? Okay. She was asking about in the act of designing, how do you incorporate some sort of essential quality into it, or how do you? She talked about the a chair can be a seat, but it can be something else. So how do you progress an idea through a design?
Through hard work, through every kind of work, even thinking, is physical work. It's thinking is not much different from laying bricks or doing some something with your muscles. So it's this process of work itself and its physicality and engagement that eventually gets you somewhere. I never practically know whether I have gotten to a resolution that is acceptable, but my body does. Until that point, I feel that I'm asymmetrical, I have pain everywhere, days and days there's pain, but then at one happy moment the pain is gone, and then you know that you got it. I think design work, or probably writing a poem or painting, sculpting, all of this is so comprehensive participation in just the act of being. I think that is what you primarily do as an artist or architect or poet, is you articulate your own sense of being. And it's difficult to say anything about it, in words, because it's fundamentally, again goes back to this idea of the flesh of the world. You just feel that you are now happily part of the world, and then you got there. One almost needs to speak metaphorically about these things, because these are not things that anyone can advise another person. You have certainly another method, and each one has to find his or her own way of approaching things. Getting started, that's the difficult moment. After I have gotten the first sentence on paper, it's almost done, because that first sentence is like a door that opens. I might even eliminate that first sentence completely, but it's still the door that opens you, your to journey to that.
To commence.
Yes.
To begin.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, we've gone a little bit over our time. I want to, first of all, thank you for staying here and for being here. But I want to thank Juhani for being so generous with his time and with his conversation, and for the next three and a half days that we have in front of us, and the amazing amount of work that he'll be expending to be that. So can we have a round of applause to Juhani?
Do you know what we are going to do with the 15 students? No?
No, they don't know.
I'll tell you. Since tomorrow is the beginning of Easter.
Good Friday.
We are going to do the space of the Last Supper in the garage at the university.
So Juhani is here as part of the workshop, and the 15 students that will be working with him have all been making a large 1-10 model of a location within the underground garage underneath the south lawn. And in that space, the space of the model, the space of the space, they'll spend the next 3 days coming up with a development of the possibility of a Last Supper taking place in this space. And if you, I know it's a holiday, but if you happen to have nothing to do on Monday, probably around 10 o'clock or so, we're going to bring the work that's been produced in the workshop back to level one in the MSD building and have a conversation review about some of the projects and some of the ideas. So you're all welcome to join us and see what has been accomplished. So again, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.